This is a production of Cornell University.
So I always like to have some other title rather than just the sort of more, you know, general explaining what it is I'm talking about, creating an app for greenhouse insect pest management. And maybe I should have called it actually Bugs in the System. But it has been very interesting working on that because we find many bugs on my part and then bugs on the part of the computer side as well. And so I'm also glad to see that Missy's here because she's one of my secret weapons in terms of making sure that things work. So when we started looking at IPM, is one of the big things about integrated pest management is that we're always looking for new tools. What can we find that makes life easier for growers, makes life easier for us, helps people in general manage their insect and disease and weed and rodent and other pests? So when we started talking to greenhouse growers, when I first came, biocontrol was just getting started. And especially with the New York State greenhouse growers, the ornamental growers, a lot of them are small, and they had not really gotten into it yet. They were just on the edge. So it's like, aha, we said, let's look at biocontrol. No problem for a grower. You're going to juggle the plant, you're going to juggle the pest, you're going to juggle the environment, and let's add another biological organism in there to make it easier for you to control these. It's very complicated in terms of what information do you need, and what factors do you have to fit into your production scheme to make biological control work. Now, I just had coffee, which was probably a bad idea. So if I'm talking faster than human beings can hear, please wave your hands. I'll try and talk slower. So the growers said, when we said that, they said, we need help. It's too much information to try and assimilate all at once. We need something to help put all this information in one place so we can look it up. So of course, we said, university people, we need paper. Let's create it with a handbook. Yeah, it's got the pests in there, the beneficials, identification, biology, monitoring, application, environment, effective pesticides, etc. It got to be a pretty big document. It wasn't just a couple of sheets and you could carry it around with you. So as we know, greenhouse growers, they're not likely to carry their manuals into the greenhouse with them at all times. They've got too many other things to worry about. So that sort of led us to the idea of, okay, more and more people are carrying their smartphones. They've got them in their pocket at all times. That's there with them. So why not take that information that was in the biocontrol manual and put it into an app? Sounds easy. And I will tell you, I'm not going to tell you exactly how to create an app. I'm not a programmer. They did have me doing a little bit of HTML language at one point. Wow, it's very exciting. And when I get to see the screens of the guys that are putting this up all together, it is complete gobbledygook. So I'm not doing that piece. So that means that step one is find someone who knows how to make an app. And step two is learn how to speak each other's language at least a little bit. And that's a huge thing. If you can't find somebody that understands what you're talking about and you understand what they're talking about, I'm not sure you can go forward. So we worked with Gorges downtown. And actually, we found them because Jenny Cow-Niffen had talked to them about doing an app. And so we were asking around. She talked about that. So we went down and they said, OK, here's how much it's going to cost. And we said, OK, put in a grant for it and got the grant. I suspect that we both learned how to make an app together. We went through several different people that worked with them, and it took a lot longer than we thought. And we finally now are at a point where the systems that they're using work for what we want to do. But it really was a discussion. It really was a joint conversation on what can an app do. So we're used to apps where you go in and you push buttons and you get information. They're actually the ones who suggested, why not make it interactive so that you can enter information that can be then compiled and recorded through the app, rather than having it just be a site just for information. So that's what we did. Again, it sounds very easy, and it's not. Also, if you have questions while I'm talking, I deal with chaos pretty well, so feel free to ask. You may have to borrow the big orange gloves if you want to ask a question. you can have those just for yourself. So when we start talking about biological control, one of the most common questions that growers had, what pest are we dealing with? So we couldn't back it past pest identification. We had to include pest identification in the app because that was where many of them were starting. And then once you know which pest it is, then what biocontrols can you use to control it and how do you do that? So that was the basis for the sort of information side of the app that we wanted to put together. And then on our part is what do we wish growers would do? We wish they'd keep records. And many of them have records of some things. They're required to keep records of pesticides, so they're used to doing that piece. What we really would have liked is if we could have this app then put all the information on their pesticides together so that it would be able to be printed out and go to DEC. It doesn't do that, unfortunately. New York State IPM does have procedures that's called track software that does that for other crops like apples and turf. We don't have it for greenhouses or Christmas trees or any of the ornamentals that I work with. And this unfortunately doesn't do that. But at least as a way to keep some of the information and maybe even print it out so that you could store it somewhere and be able to go back and look and say, what pests did we see? When did we see them? What did we do? And did it work? And to be able to then plan better for the next time around. And I will say, working with growers on biological control, I would say it takes about 3 years before they have the system in place and functioning pretty well so that it's not a constant, oh my gosh, what do we do now, or what's happening with this? It takes about that long to get the populations down low enough. It also takes about that long to have the biocontrol fit into your production scheme so that it is just routine. And so keeping records actually helps get to that point faster. So what does this app do then? So it does, if you look at the list of what it does, it covers most of those things that we had in the biocontrol workbook or handbook. Pest ID in biology, beneficial ID in biology, application methods, so how do you put those beneficials on, pesticide interactions. Okay, I'm gonna ask you guys questions because that keeps everybody awake. Why do we need pesticide interactions in a biocontrol app? Good, Neil knows. He's been around me a long time. Neil.
Because the pesticides can also be harmful to the beneficial.
Right. So there's information out there on which pesticides are better and worse for the beneficials that you're going to put down. And if you've just spent a lot of money putting beneficials out, which it does cost a fair amount, and then you spray something that kills them and wall off, it's probably not worth your while. So knowing something about which ones you can mix. Also with growers, and it took a while to, I think, convince people of this, biological control does not preclude the use of pesticides. We see it as an integrated system. So maybe you're using biological control through the whole first section of the production, and then before you're going to sell those plants, you get an application of pesticide. Or perhaps you're doing most of your pest control with biologicals, and then you've got a hot spot of something else that comes in, and you can apply a pesticide to that. So it is not an either-or system. It is a both. It can be either or, but it is often a both system. And in order to have that system work well, you need to have information on the pesticides and how they interact with the beneficials. You get a point, Neil. And then interactive scouting. So this is the concept of actually having being able to put information into the app and have it stored. And then the record keeping for both the scouting and then beneficial and pesticide applications. And then a way to graph this information so you can see what's happening over time. We have it available on Android and Apple, and it is still only $9.99. So if you search for Greenhouse Scout, you'll find it. Why did we charge for it? Apple actually charges us, they get part of that money. We wanted it to be not very expensive so that people could get it just to try it out even, and then we need to have money to go back into the system to maintain it. And that's one of the big issues when we started out, is that you can create one, but it has to be maintained. And the question then is, how is it maintained? And who's going to maintain it? And maintenance always costs money. So that's one reason for charging. I think the food is here.
Betsy, yeah. Are the people who developed it maintaining it?
They are. And that was something that was unusual, and we had to work with Cornell to allow that. So I had to go through the intellectual property office because of the app. And so they're like, great, so usually when money comes into the system, it gets divided out into departments, PIs, and the university. And I said, that's great, except that if the Cornell's going to maintain it, I'm okay with that. If Cornell's not going to maintain it, then we have to figure out a way. So Gorges actually worked with Cornell to have all the money come back to them, and that's our maintenance fund. And that's also then why we have to market it, because we need to get people to know about it. And you need to do that in a digital world. You need to probably be doing that every 15 seconds. I'm not doing it that often, but we need to keep talking about it and get it out to other populations so that people can will buy it and we can keep it maintained. And it does take a lot of maintenance on both everybody's part. So the way this is set up, it's a little bit unusual. There's a web-based component and then a smart device-based component to this app. And the web-based component in part is administration, so that's the part that I get to use to add information. It's also where the information is stored. And then for the user side of it, we have somewhere where they have to create locations. And I'll show you what locations means as we go along. And then on the smart device side of it, that's where there's sort of information retrieval from by a user, and then you can also collect information through the scouting on that side. And so instead of actually using the real app, because scrolling, I think, might make everyone dizzy and sick to their stomachs, I've actually got screenshots. I brought my iPad. If anyone wants to play with it at the end, you can come up and play with it on my iPad. So on this I want information side of things. And also, there's also regulations by Apple. Now, we learned that you cannot require an account be made without giving them some information that is free. It's not free because they had to pay for the app, but you have to give them information that does not require collecting any demographic information or anything. All we ask for is zip code. But so that there's on the smart device, there's a whole lot of it that you can do without creating an account, that sort of information. So that's pest beneficials, application technology, and pesticide interactions. So this is what it looks like when you get it, depending on whether you're on an iPhone or an iPad, bigger or smaller. Just a set of buttons, and we hope they're fairly clear as to what they do. It's interesting when we've got application technology, and we're calling this an app, which is an application. And so, again, sometimes the computer terminology and the scientific terminology or the user's technology overlaps. So you can get to all of these things several ways, and we wanted to have it be that way so that wherever you are, you can find a way to get to the information you want. And I'll show some of that as we go along, too. So one of the easy ways is you start with the buttons. See, this is, yep, so, oh, it doesn't show, oh, I'm showing you on the wrong thing. That's what I'm looking at. So this is a hamburger. See, I learned that. I never knew about it. Did you know that's called a hamburger? That's a hamburger, and when you click on that, you'll also get a written menu that'll show up on the side. So if the buttons aren't working for you, you can also get the menu there, but that also is where you can log in and out and so forth. So to use Scout or application, you have to be logged in. For the other ones, you don't. And then from page to page, we have it set up so you can go page to page also. So this was set up for greenhouse ornamentals. It's pretty adaptable to greenhouse vegetable crops also, and you'll see hops at the end, and also to some extent to greenhouse production of hops. But that's where the pests came in. And so for each one of these groups, you can click on it. And so if you click on aphids, you'll get green peach aphid and potato aphid and foxglove aphid as a list. And then you can go into those pests. As I said, one of the things that's nice is that if you get a request to add a pest, we can actually add them pretty easily. And that's, I think, that to me is an innovation in that I don't have to go back to the company every time. For them to add information, I can do it. So here's the Western Flower Thrips page, the beginning of the page. And then these buttons are all live. So if you come in, if you're like, I think I've got Western Flower Thrips. So you come into that page and I'm like, oh, which beneficials will work? You can click any of these and go to the beneficials page directly. So we're always trying to think about how people think about information and where they go from where. But on this on the pest page, this is an example of a pest page. There's the beneficials, damage cause, biology, monitoring methods, photographs, life cycle, and environment. So it starts like that. It's a long, oops. I hit the mute. Hit it again. All right. Okay, so you can scroll down from those beneficials to biology and identification. We've got pictures in there so that people can look at them, but also some as much information as we can find in terms of what kind of damage would you expect to see from that pest. What information from the biological side would be useful in terms of if you're trying to manage it, how do you monitor it, and then, you know, is there some information on the environment that affects the development of the pest also? And so for each one of those, we can scroll down. So this is now on the website. That picture, all that other information was on the smart device side. This is how I would add a new pest and the information that would go in. So I would put in the scientific name, the common name. And there's pest type. There's a list of different pests. That list of pests I showed you, aphids, spider mites, and so forth. I can actually add more. If for some reason we get some other new kind of pest that's a whole different pest type, I can actually just add a new one. And then this is the list of beneficials that we have in the system. I can add new ones of those if I need to. And when you're putting up a new pest, you just say, okay, here's the ones that are used to control that. And then for each of those segments on the smart device, there's just a block box to put content in. And so it's very easy. Yep.
Betsy, are you, as administrator, the only individual who can modify the site?
Brian Eschenauer is an administrator, and then some of the gorgeous people are also administrators, but there's not very many of us. Mm-hmm. Right. So if you had an account with it, you would see all of this information up here, except for you'd see your own name, but you wouldn't see admin, because that's only if you're an administrator. Yep. And it probably helps to have not too many people in there.
Right.
The gorgeous guys probably are not going in there much. This is the idea then of a beneficials page. And again, it's the same sort of thing where you say, okay, I've got cucumeris to control western flower thrips. What else will it control? And then you can flip back and forth between beneficials and pests. And then the same idea that I'm going to do that again, aren't I? So biology and identification information, and we have it standardized as to what kind of information goes in. There are pictures, life cycle and environment. And then application methods, and you can see here an example of things that we learn as we go along. I don't know where all the periods went. I'll have to go back in and make sure all the periods are actually in there. They disappeared when I wrote it. There are none in here. Oh, there's one.
And another one.
A couple, but I don't read. So they're randomly there or not there. But here's one too where it says you can see the application technology page for more information. Another place where we have a bit of information. Here's the specifics just for this beneficial. But on the application technology page, we have more information. So it would look like this. If you click this application technology button, you would get places to find information, and then you could scroll down through the different beneficials to see if there's more than one way of applying it. Because sometimes you don't know that when you first find out about it. And so if you want to just sprinkle it over the foliage, that's one method of applying it. But applying it in a sachet works better for certain situations in ornamentals. Longer term management, easier to put on if you've got plants that are in hanging baskets, all sorts of things. It's nice to know if there's multiple methods of applying it. So you can see for Aphelinus, there's only one, but for Andersoni, which is a mite, there's more than one. And then ways to check for viability. And this is really important from our point of view. If you buy something and it's dead, it's not going to work, probably. But how do you know if it's alive or dead? Well, you can. Sometimes you can see them, but sometimes you're putting pupae out. You don't know if they're alive or dead. So is there a way you can take those pupae that you purchased, put them in a jar with a yellow sticky trap, and watch the wasps? You can count the number of wasps that hatch. So that's something that would be true for wasps. If it's a mite, we want you to mix it in the carrier, sprinkle it out, or cut open a sachet, and see if you can see the mites running around. And you need to know something about them sometimes to know which mites you're seeing, because there are food mites in there for the predator mites as well. So information on how you might know whether what you purchased is actually alive. And then there's a button for pesticide interactions here. And when you click on that, you get this kind of a table. So this information all comes from side effects lists that are put out by the companies that sell beneficials. But the pesticides are based on the Cornell guidelines. So they're sort of New York oriented. And they are the ones for the greenhouse and ornamentals. So they're not all the vegetable crops ones also. We could add that if we had a lot of people saying we want to use this for vegetable crops. We could add that. And some of them overlap. But so the information is usually based on the stage of the beneficial. If they know, you can see there's lots of blanks. They don't know that information. And then it's 4 is very, very toxic to the beneficial. It goes down to 1, which is least toxic. And then this is a big deal. Because if you've got something that's very toxic, but it only persists 2 weeks, that means you can come back in with beneficials in 2 weeks. If it's greater than 8 weeks, you're out of business for ornamental bedding plants. It's too long a time. So once you've put that pesticide on, you're not going to be putting any more of those beneficials on. So that information is really useful in terms of, again, as I said, for managing those the sort of interactions between the pesticides and the beneficials that you might be using. Then on the scouting side of the things, that's where you have to use both the web and the app. And that you can add information either way, which is sometimes useful if you've got a bunch of scouts and they're all scouting in, on clipboards, and then they might send, take their sheets to a central place to have the information put on. You can actually have multiple scouts scouting on the same account. They each have, they have to have each paid to have the app on their smart device, but they can count, they can work on the same account so that all that information would go in. So if you've got a greenhouse grower in range one and a different grower in range two, they can scout on the same app, so all the information goes into the head grower. And then it's easier to see charts on the website, but you can also see them on the smart device. But if you've just got a small screen, it's harder to see details. So if this is where you're, if you're going to create a location to where you're going to scout, you'd come in on the website, and this is the page that you would see. And we set it up so that there are two levels of location. And location could be anything. It could be a physical location, but it could also be a crop. So it could be petunias. Because in some greenhouses, the petunias move around. Well, the pests are going to move around with the petunias. They're not going to stay in the location. So the crop is actually more important than the physical location. But you can put in as much as you want. You could say this is range one, greenhouse five, bench three, and then have four cards in addition to that. And the idea is you can put in anything there that you want. It doesn't have to be anything set. It'll create the greenhouse one, two, three, four if you just let it do whatever it wants, and card numbers. But, and cards don't actually have to be cards. We think about cards because we're counting things on yellow sticky cards, but if you're talking about aphids, you're not likely to see them on yellow sticky cards unless you're really not paying attention and now you have alate ones that are flying around and getting stuck. So it might be that you're looking at a plant to count aphids. You can also do it in terms of when you're looking at them. You can have an actual number, or you can have something that's like, okay, if I put down zero, it means there aren't any. If I put down one, there are a few. If I put down 10, there's kind of a medium amount. If I put down 100, there's a lot. So it'll still graph out to show you what's going on with the population, but you don't have to have an exact count. You don't, it's not specific that it has to have a exact counts. So when you're setting up your locations, you're also going to choose which pests you're going to scout. And then also down below here, if you scroll down, you can also choose beneficials. Why would I have beneficials? Why am I scouting for beneficials?
See if they're there.
So if you've released, if you think you've released wasps, you might catch your wasps on your yellow sticky cards. And then you know that they're there. The other thing is we find sometimes people are like, well, let's be efficient and we're going to put our banker plants with these wasps, we're producing the wasps right next to the yellow sticky card. You're going to catch a lot of wasps. You should actually separate them. If you're catching too many wasps on your sticky cards, you might need to think about where you're putting your sticky cards. So that's sort of useful information, I guess, too. And then once you create a location, the system actually creates a QR code. And you can print it out, and the idea is we want to be able to, so you can print it out, you can maybe shrink it down, print it out. We also made sure that it actually says where it is, because a bunch of pieces of paper with QR codes that don't tell you where they are is not very useful, that we learned that in the middle of it doing all this. And then, so then you can come into an area, you can just shoot the QR code with your smart device, and it knows where you are, and it will load all that information that you put there. Does it work, Missy? So Missy is, that's why she's, the secret, she's my secret weapon, because she's actually using this. And when she finds bugs, she tells me. And that's great. We need to know what works and what doesn't work. So that was, again, we're trying to make it easy when you're going scouting. And then when you're on your smart device, this is what it looks like. So it'll automatically, you can either select the location by hand, or you can shoot the QR code. And then it gives you the date, the current date. But if you want to change the date, you can. Because you might want to go back and add information to something. And then it's got the locations, and then it, whatever you chose to be that you were going to scout is here. But this is also important, because sometimes you said, okay, we usually it's peppers. We have aphids, and we have white flies. But then you're there, and suddenly you've got thrips on them. So you want to be able to add that so you can still count them. And then the same thing is true. This is on the website, but when you're creating an application report, it would look much like the picture that I just showed you for the scouting report. Same thing in that it'll pull the date up. You tell it where you are. And then because with applications of beneficial or pesticides, you might apply them over a larger area so that you don't have to go in for each one and do the scouting report or the application report. You can tell it, okay, we're in greenhouse one, and we're going to put it over the whole area that's covered by all of those cards. So you can add them all in once. It also knows what you're targeting, and again, you can add a different one if you need to. And you can put on either a beneficial or a pesticide. You can do multiple applications on the same day, but you have to do them on different application reports. Because if you put in a beneficial and then put in a pesticide, it'll say you can't do both. And then you're going to put in rates and, rates and units. And we all have a lot of places for notes in case there's something that you need to remember when you went in there and you're doing that. And the other thing that's nice is when you're on the web anyway, it shows you all the previous applications, so you can see what you've done already. It doesn't show those on the smart device. So this is the web. Once you've got a location created, you can do lots of different things. You can go back and find the QR code again. You can look. You can add a new Scout report or a new application report. You can change data if you need to. And then reports is the part that is I think, useful in terms of saying, okay, so we did all these things, what's happening? So this is a typical graph of fake data. But so the idea being, so what are the fungus? Each color is a different insect. What are the numbers doing over time? And then these vertical bars are applications. So here, look at that. We had fungus gnats increasing. We put nematodes on, and hooray, they dropped down. But that's what we wanted to be able to say. Oh, look, you can see it. It's fast. You can look at that quickly and say that something is happening or not happening. And then all this, you would all scroll down. Every application or every scouting report and application report is listed in the, so you can scroll down through them and see what the actual information is. And there are also filters. It doesn't show on this picture, but there are filters. So I can say, okay, I don't want to look at all these pests. I just want to look at one. Or I don't want to look at all these dates. I just want to look at this range. Or I just want to look at something in particular. And then also you can print these. You can print the graphs and all this data from this page as well. So I've covered some of these pros and cons as I've gone along. It's easy to add information and or change information. There's a direct contact us button that goes both to me and to Gorges. So if I get a question, I know what's going on, and sometimes I can answer them, or sometimes I can go to Gorges and saying, okay, they're having these problems, what do we do? Multiple people can scout into the same account. The cons are, I used to say it was like having a baby. Now I say it's like having a hormonal teenager. Because invariably, you change one thing, and something else happens over here. And you have to keep looking at it to make sure what happened when you did whatever you did. And that, so it does take maintenance, and I'm not sure I'm as good as I should be on maintaining maintenance on my side, where I need to make sure that all the information stays up to date, but I try. And then on their side, when things go wrong, they have to go in back in and figure it out. And it does require marketing. So we've sold about 300 of these, so that's pretty good, I think, as a start. And then the next thing is, okay, what's next? So I need to load the updates on Greenhouse, but we have two more, two that I'm involved with and a third one. Once Gorges came up with this system, it's like, well, we might as well use the same framework for additional systems. So we've got Conifer Scout in the works. This is a picture of the Conifer Scout, and you can see it's got some of the same icons, and then it's got some additional things in there in terms of diseases are in the Conifer Scout and weeds. There's a Hop Scout for both field and greenhouse that we're working on that one. And then someone else took the format from IBM and did a sweet corn scouting app using the same sort of thing. So once you've got that system, it makes it easier to do. That's all that I have. We have time for questions. Does anyone have any questions?
Questions? Again, referring to it, probably not the most polite question, but how much would this cost?
It costs $15,000. I figured somebody would ask that. So when we went in originally with Gorges, it cost $15,000. I will lay you odds that they spent more than that in terms of people's time on getting it set up. So now when we go in and do another one, we still pay $15,000 for the next one. And I think the idea is, okay, we're kind of, at some point we'll come out even. So yes, and as I say, I think we all learned how to do this together. Whether or not, if you went now and said, we want to start from scratch and create an app, whether they'd say, oh yeah, it's going to cost you much more, I don't know. But the system they have now seems to be easier to work with and faster. Either it's the system or the person doing it, I'm not sure, but I think it's the system as well. So even though we're using the same framework for the next one, there's still some additional work that has to be done, so it's not certainly not free to do it. I wanted to actually translate Greenhouse Scout into Spanish and French. I had a request from Quebec to do French. And so I don't know, I need to ask them, if we want to translate it, is that going to cost the same amount or would that be cheaper to do? But I don't know that answer yet. So, yep.
So in the 11 years that you've been doing Greenhouse IBM Betsy, have you either seen anecdotally or do you have data on the amount of reduction in pesticide use?
We don't have very good information on the amount of pesticide use and reduction in pesticide use, and it is the information that we would love to have and is kind of difficult to collect. We do have information that shows that there's an increasing number of growers using biological control. And the assumption is if that's true, then there should be a reduction in pesticide use. And we also, it's like, we'd like to have more efficient pesticide use, which would also then reduce pesticide use. But it is the information we always want, and we're not as good at figuring out how to find it. For that, we need actually growers who will give us all their data on their pesticide applications as well. And it really should be, I think we need to look at it over a 3-year span to be able to say we've actually reduced this. Sorry.
Awesome. Have you considered maybe like a freemium model where for free you could maybe just access some basic information, but if you wanted to set up locations or more intensive, larger scale things, you have to pay for extra services that we could get?
We did, but the biggest problem is having a maintenance fund to keep the whole thing going. And so that's why we were trying to keep it down at 5, but then when we found out that Apple took this much already, it was like, well, there's nothing. So we figured that $10 is low enough that it hopefully is not keeping anybody out from using it. But it would be nice to have it free, but we didn't ever figure out a way to do that.
Well, I just meant like some of the
right
tiered services.
Right. And so, I mean, the way it's set up now, there are sort of two levels that it's not changing price, but it's whether or not you create an account. So I could see you could do that pretty easily. But, yeah.
Are you collecting any of the data on the back end so you get an idea of, say, that pesticide usage or other things that may be anonymized a little bit, or regional check or outbreaks?
Right. Yeah. We have the ability to look at it. We haven't had too many people using it for scouting, or not as many people using it for scouting, but it's one of those things where I need about a week to go in there and sit there and look through it and see if we can see who's using it for scouting even, and then, yeah, what kind of information are they seeing, and can we collect information from that side to be able to use and to be able to say, yeah, I'm not sure we could actually prove a reduction in pesticides unless we had scouting data from somebody for over multiple years, an individual account. But the potential is there. So yeah.
And can we see if Geneva has questions?
I can. Geneva, do you have any questions?
I have a question. Collecting zip code information, and I'm curious if the app includes any outlets for people in the same region maybe to connect, whether that's just through a discussion forum or I don't know, some other format. But is there any connectivity between app users right now?
That's a great question. I never thought of it. It's really a good idea, and we should see that might be something that we could do, because that would also give us information about what kinds of what things people are looking for. So thank you. I'll have to go and see if I can figure out a way to do that. We have, we would have to put it up on the front end because, I'm trying to think, if we have email addresses. We might have email addresses, and so it might be something we could do that way. But otherwise, we'd have to put it up on the front end that sort of says, if you'd like to be part of a discussion group, here's how you join in. That's a great question. Thanks.
Hire Hannah to do that.
Yeah. I know she doesn't. She has lots of time, I know. Any other questions, Geneva?
Another question, Mary. So is there any way that you can share this information with like multiple people, like say, there's like a range of houses and those people don't scout, but you want to share those information with say multiple like users, like 20 users?
So if they're working on the same account, if they're all putting their information into the same account, they can all see that information. So if
only one person is doing it and you want to share this or like download this information and share it with everybody else.
So there's two ways you could do it. Someone else could buy the app and then just use the same account information to log in, and they could see the information even if they weren't adding information. And the other thing you could do is actually print off those graphs and tables and then share it in a hard copy. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Great, thanks. Any other questions here?
Yeah. How are you all advertising?
That is also another excellent question. It's kind of tough. Well, now we did, in 2015, we made the 15 top greenhouse apps. that was nice. That was information that we didn't have to go out and promote. And we try and send it out periodically. Whenever you do something new, you get a chance to advertise it again. That's another reason for actually translating it. And so we've done a lot of, with the presentations that we do out to growers in the state, we've done a lot of that. I got invited to Calgary, Alberta to talk to the Alberta growers and present the information. Brian Eschenauer was the other half of my team, presented it for the plant and soil program that they had in January last year. So that's one of the things you have to keep talking about it. But you know, we kind of get done with it, and it's like, oh, it's old news. Do we go out and talk about it again? But that's what we need to do. And that's a whole nother, it's another job. But yeah, so anytime we can find somebody that wants to send out the information, we can make that. Yep.
Have your users identified pests that you hadn't necessarily thought of?
Yes.
Before?
I had one that I added in there that I was requested. It was a thrips. Is that right? And so, yeah, they said, we need this one. And so it's like, great, if you can either send me information or if I can find the information to fill in all those blanks, I'll put it in. So I did that. And so that's, as I say, that the fact that I can do that without having to go back to the company, which would cost money, is a wonderful thing. It makes life pretty easy. And we do sometimes get new information on beneficials as well.
Yeah, so do you keep track of how many downloads so far? And do you see a trend that growers or even people wanting to IBM start using this?
Yes, and you can always see whatever I've just talked about it. I think if you track that, you would see, oh yes, we did a presentation for the AERDC, the organization that was here for their meeting last year, and yep, there's a bump there. I can actually go in and see all the names too, but I think that's one of the things that, again, that goes back to the question about advertising it. Every time we advertise it, we get a bump. And because otherwise it's not out there. You know, in terms of things that are digital, you know, we're not hitting anybody's top list of the apps of the year. Not we're in competition with game apps. So I mean, if you Google greenhouse, we might be in the top greenhouse. Yeah, as I said, there's about 300 people on the list, and so that kind of comes in funny little chunks. And then sometimes people will tell each other, which is useful.
Yep. So for something like this, that the people who have bought it should also have an annual fee to pay for the maintenance. It's not just a one-time thing, because essentially your maintenance fees are coming on the heels of new people who sign up.
Yep.
Can you go back in and...
I'm sure there are apps that do that.
With Apple, I mean, can you institute a $2 a year maintenance fee? Is that permissible?
I suspect it can be done, and there are probably some apps that do it, but I don't think there's many. Does anybody know of an app that has a maintenance fee that you have to go in? I can't think of any. And so whether or not it's possible, I don't know. But you're right. We are trying to get maintenance from people, and it's a one-time purchase. And so
it's like a subscription.
Right.
There are apps that you have to renew every year. So like I have a family calendar app that you can pay $30, but it's $30 every year to have that.
So then the question is, would people pay that? And it kind of depends on how much use they're seeing. If they, you know, if they think it's useful, and it's like the other problem then too is like, oh, you don't pay it one time, and now all your data, unless you have downloaded it all, it's gone. And so, but we didn't actually discuss the concept of having a recurring payment, and I don't see with the next two, maybe that's something that we do, or we put it up at a higher price. It's hard to decide too what's cheap anymore. I'm cheap, so that I think $10 is like, okay, that's kind of a breakpoint. Maybe $25 is a breakpoint for other people, not considered too expensive to at least try now.
So, any other questions for Betsy? If not, let's thank Betsy.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.